my name is Vikas, and you know what she mentioned was a little outdated. I've been with Paytm for about 2 years now, and I primarily look after building data products and data science products, primarily big data and data science products at Paytm. We are one of the oldest and one of the largest users of AWS services. We pretty much use all the AWS services, and anything new that comes up, we get our hands on it, do POCs, reach out to AWS for any support that we need. In this talk, I'll be talking a little bit about what Paytm is, what it wants to be in the next couple of years, what we are doing in the AI space, and how we have achieved what we have achieved so far. If time permits, I will go with a simple use case on optical character recognition, and this is broadly the agenda for this talk. What is Paytm? So Paytm is about an 8-year-old organization. Initially Paytm used to be 197, which is more of a telco business, and about 7-8 years ago Paytm got into QR code payments, and it has evolved much more from payments. What we are today is we are becoming more like a super app for consumers and businesses, wherein we have flight bookings, we have movie bookings, we have e-commerce, we have wealth management, and going forward we'll add many more things into our app. We want to become one of the one-stop solutions for any human needs, and how we use data. So if you think about us, we are a mix of too many companies in one company, and we leverage data from wherever it is generated to be able to do better recommendations, better personalizations. I'll talk a little bit about how we have built this data infrastructure. It is massive scale. It requires a lot of understanding of data sets from different verticals, different businesses, and how we will be able to achieve that, to centralize that piece. I'll talk about that, and why it has really helped us. So a little bit about this Paytm. We aim to bring 500 million people to do transactions on Paytm and do all things that they want, book tickets, do payments, shop for their daily needs, everything. On the customer side, we have roughly around 300 to 400 million right now. And our merchant base is growing at a very healthy rate. You can see this number is probably a little outdated. It's June 19. Right now we are somewhere around 15 million. We started off with payments, and we have evolved from payments to we have business services that we provide to all our merchants, about 15 million of them. And then we have e-commerce. We have we've got into financial services with Paytm Money, and we also have a bank. Given that we do so many things, and AI becomes absolute necessary for us to be able to do better personalization, to be able to use the 5-inch or 6-inch or 7-inch screen judiciously, which is the app, and data security again is important. Data quality is important. We use AI to, and I'll talk about one use case where we use AI for securing data and improving our workforce efficiency. I talk about this that super app needs to have easy discoverability. If you open Paytm, You'll probably see movies, recharges, tolls, FASTag. So all of those icons that you see on the app are very personalized. They change as per your behavior, and they're different for different people. It is only to make sure that, you know, you don't have to go deep into all the things that we have. So whatever you need, you should get it on the front page itself. There are a lot of things that we do for different business verticals, and a couple of things that I have mentioned here. So we do a lot of AI and ML. We've built AI and ML products for fraud detection. We do lending for small and medium enterprises and also for customers. We do insurance. We do field force optimization, which is more on the workforce efficiency. And all of these solutions, we use data across different business verticals, and that is where, you know, our data platform is the key to our success today. We also have worked on a lot of commerce-related machine learning and data science products. We do personalization, as I spoke about. We do chatbot, we do recommendations. How did we do all of these things? I mean, somebody may have that question, and I have it. So this is a very, very important slide. Before I come on this, I'll talk a little bit about this. So this is the kind of scale that we are talking about. We have close to 3,000 plus data sets across different business verticals. We have about 6+ petabytes of data, which is huge. We have built around 20,000 plus features, which is pretty much the backbone of any machine learning product that we built. And we have more than 2,000 data processing jobs, for which we use AWS EMR. Let me come back to this now. Now, having 3,000 plus data sets, you know, in a centralized fashion, so that it is available to everybody, it is discoverable, it does not breach the SLA. To do all of these things, you know, we had to build a very strong data platform. We have a lot of different platforms that we've built within the organization. So one of the platforms that we can talk about is the ingestion layer. The ingestion layer typically takes data from any source. So it has a source and it has a target. Typically, most of the time, you know, our data lake is based out of AWS S3, and all of the data that we ingest resides in S3. Onboarding a data set is a one-click job because of the framework that we have built at Paytm. The source data can be in any database. It can be in MySQL, it can be Oracle, it can be MongoDB, it can be Cassandra, it can be, and even we do ingest from Elasticsearch. So we have written, you know, all of that. We have built all of those connectors. We have created that framework wherein we can ingest data from any source. There are two types of ingestion pipelines that we run. One is the batch ingestion, and the other is real-time ingestion. So for batch ingestion, obviously, we take some periodic amount of data, and then for real-time, it is more of a change data capture mechanism that we use. From this data ingestion layer, we use we have a lot of data sets, and then we have something called as a data catalog. Data catalog becomes important because many people in the organization do not know about what data sets the other business verticals have and what kind of features are available. So we have created a platform where we have easy data discovery. So data set discovery platform is there. We have a feature generation platform, again, which we have democratized because we realize that it becomes a bottleneck when we do everything centralized. So at one point in time, you know, we were decentralized and we had to decentralize things, but at the same time, we had to have strict guidelines on how to use the platform so that it is optimized and we do not create redundant features. So even our feature generation platform for which, you know, we primarily use Spark on EMR. We also use AWS Glue for that, and AWS Glue allows us to democratize this, so people can actually write their scripts in any language that they want. They can write a SQL script, and it will be converted to a Spark job. So I think this pretty much, you know, is the key to data discovery and data availability at Paytm. Then we have some ML tools that we use and dataset 7 layers. So this, had this not been there, we would not have been where we are today. So I consider that this is the most critical part of where we are today and why we are here. Now I'll talk a little bit about one simple use case that we worked upon and why this was important. So we get a lot of before I come here, the features that we built are important for many machine learning models that we built. This is a deep learning use case that we had built on AWS SageMaker, and so we typically used to get a lot of documents from multiple various sources. Be that KYC, be that merchant onboarding, be that somebody trying to open a DMAT account, be that somebody trying to open a bank account. Now, validating the documents with the information provided, and at the same time, securing those documents. Because, you know, the kind of document that we used to get is Aadhaar, PAN card, voter ID, and passport. So all these are pretty confidential documents, and as per regulations, we can store these documents, but we need to redact the keys. So the Aadhaar number has to be redacted. It should not be available to anybody. So this was an important problem, and we had a lot of operational workforce which was getting involved in validating and redacting, primarily because of the number of customers that we have and the number of documents that we get on a daily basis. And the second challenge that we had was the kind of documents that we were getting were of all different kinds. So we used to get images, we used to get PDFs, we used to get images of images. So somebody has an image on his phone and one will click another image on top of that. So the kind of documents were, and it was very hard for any standard algorithm or standard product available in the market to be able to give us a reasonable accuracy on so what we did, and also secondly, because this data was pretty confidential, it was not easy to get this data even for us while we are custodians of that data, but still so we took a very small set of that data to solve that problem. About 3,000 odd documents is something that we took. We had to create much more documents to be able to train a deep learning model. So, So we did a lot of augmentation on that documents. So those images that we get, that we got, we created almost 50 to 80 images per image. So we flipped it, we rotated it, we added some grayscale on it, all different kinds of, we added noise, we rotated it. So all different kinds of noise that we could put in that image, we did that. And finally, we were able to get about 60, 70x of the number of documents that we had. So we had 3,000 initially, and then we landed up with around 2 lakhs. The choice of algorithms the next was the choice of algorithm that we had to use. While there were many algorithms available, but there was a recent paper in 2018, and one can go and read about it. So that paper talks about an algorithm called PSENet. It is Progressive Scale Expansion Network, and it has two interesting things that it does. Firstly, it learns the pattern of text in a document. So for example, if you have a PAN card, it will learn the pattern that, you know, there will be an income tax department on the top, and then there will be some other text, and then finally there will be a name, date of birth. So it learns the pattern. Secondly, it also creates the bounding boxes around the text. So these are the two things that that got us excited to use this algorithm. So after using this algorithm on every image, so what we got is, you know, a bounding box on every text. So for example, if there is a PAN card, there's, let's say, name Vikas Panani, and then there will be one box on that. So we had to actually, not one box, there will be three boxes. So one will be one box on top of name, the other box on top of the colon that we have, and the third box on top of the name. Again, two boxes. So if there are like two words, two boxes. Then the next step was to stitch these relevant regions. So again, there is a little bit of heuristics that was involved here. And again, that is configurable different for different documents. In a line, you may have name and then colon and then two, three words, whatever it is. We stitched it together, and then after stitching it, we extracted it. We used Tesseract for extracting. And finally, we applied regular expressions on top of the extracted text that we had. Now, this can be a different kind of problem if we have unstructured documents. So these are structured documents, right? So PAN card, Aadhaar, they're structured documents. When we get unstructured documents, like say, for example, some legal notice or something like that. So when we get unstructured document, then the step five will again be broken down into multiple parts. Probably we'll have to apply some kind of a natural language processing algorithms over there. But that is a different problem that we can talk about later if somebody wants to. Once we had this text, now we wanted to check, you know, how accurate our results are. So because we had some labeled data, and because we took very small samples, so we labeled it. The accuracy we measured in terms of the Levenstein distance between these two strings, the string that we got from 0.5 here, and the actual data that we had. So Levenstein distance, again, you know, we had a threshold on top of that. If the Levenstein distance is greater than, say, for example, 3, then we discard it. At the end, the kind of accuracy that we reached was somewhere around 87%, which was much better than, you know, any other open source or any other product that we saw. Over here, this entire exercise helped us to improve, you know, a lot of workforce efficiency. Like for example, a lot of our agents were involved in validating the data that we get from the document and the data that the customers have provided us. So that validation became much more smoother and faster. The second thing that we also did is once we got the text, we obviously redacted it. So by redaction, I mean if there is a 12-digit Aadhaar number, we cross out the first 8 digits and we only keep the last 4 digits. So that is the kind of document that regulation allows us to keep, and that is what we were able to achieve using this. The entire solution was built on top of AWS. So SageMaker is something that we used, SageMaker has NVIDIA processors on which we can use CUDA processing, which makes it faster. So we tried this on GPUs as well as CPUs. On GPUs, typical serving time for one document on CPUs were about 7 seconds, and on GPUs it was about 1 second. So yeah, that's it. So as I told earlier, you know, we have been one of the largest users of I think it is pretty much time. So I'll just quickly talk about the AWS advantage that we have. We use a lot of AWS services. We use SageMaker, we use AWS Glue, we use Athena. Obviously, our data lake is based on S3 that contains 6+ petabytes of data. So yeah, thank you very much. And I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you so much for that, Vikas. Navneetan is also back with us on the dais. So if you have questions to both of them, please grab a mic. And we have about 2.5 minutes left. Anybody has a question? OK, right here. I'll
give you. Yeah. Oh, I think.
Hi, my name is Sayan, and I have worked on the similar projects that you are talking about, like document processing and things. And I have actually worked on the same KYC verification process regarding Aadhaar card and things. Like when you are talking about the training process and thing, and you talked about 70% accuracy. So how did you guys come up with a better tesseract person? Like, did you guys train any model in-house for the better OCR, or you guys just use PyTesseract or Tesseract or Amazon?
So in the latest version of Tesseract that we have, Tesseract 4, it contains a LSTM-based trained model, and that is what we have used. But, you know, largely, most of the work is done by PSENet because it is able to create proper bounding boxes that Tesseract will be able to identify and extract. So have a look at the paper that I spoke about. It was released in 2018, Progressive Scale Expansion Network. And if you want more information on this, I'll be happy to provide you more information on this. Yeah, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my question is fairly simple. You spoke about redacting Aadhaar numbers and things like that. So my basic question is, how are you guys redacting that in the text or in the images?
And if so,
in the images, then what kind of basic triggers are you guys looking for to actually identify if something is critical or something isn't? So like a name versus another hard number, things like that.
So as I told you earlier that it depends on document from document. In Aadhaar card, probably you'll find Aadhaar number somewhere in between, or somewhere on the top, and PAN number probably somewhere else, and even passport. So the kind of solution that we build is what we have done is everything is configurable, so every document is treated separately, and while we can definitely think and in terms of how we do natural language understanding to identify that this is the number that we're talking about and this is not some PIN code. But as of date, what we have done is we have configured it for every document that we encounter. Thank you.
Yeah. So you told about multi-tenant AI system.
Yep.
How you basically work with the new customers who are signing up with you?
Right, great question. So there are a couple of things, right? First of all, for any of our algorithms to work in a custom per customer basis, I suppose, we have to have enough data, right? So, and when I say enough data, we have to have a good enough, we have to be able to build a good enough model. So we tell them that, typically it takes 30 to 45 days for them to amass enough data in our system, or if they're importing it, that's another way they can get it in there. So once we're able to build a new model for them, we have a push process where we say that, okay, we have this feature enabled for you. You can turn it on in your own account. And at that point, the feature becomes enabled and they start seeing predictions in their account. But until then, we don't allow them to enable the feature by themselves because we don't know if we'll have good enough models. So we follow a push process that says that the minute we have a good enough model for you, we'll let you know. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. So it means that first you collect the data.
Yes.
Then you ask them to enable this feature for them.
Yeah. Right? So collect the data, build the model, test it, ensure that it's of high enough quality, and then only enable it or inform them that it's available.
So you mean that there is an engineer always working for that model, so that you can test this thing that it is a good quality.
No.
So how you are checking the quality of each and every customers?
Right. So we have standard accuracy benchmarks. We look at precision, recall, and F1. And we also look at coverage. So the models output both a prediction and a confidence. We look at the confidence has to be at least, say, 0.5, just as an example. And we only look at accuracies above 0.5. So we say that if we have 80% accuracy and 50% coverage, so 50% of our predictions are above 0.5, then we'll enable the model for you. I mean, this is just an example.
Yeah,
it can vary.
Got it.
Yeah. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, cool.